So the graphics is there to illustrate it's supposed to connect people with solar power in remote places. We've already done that. Around the refugee crisis, we started to think about, hey, how great would it be to have a solar relay station that is mesh capable? And so I started to build these. And we got some funding from the Ministry of Education and Research. So we, together with Knut, we made a system so you can monitor these devices, and you have a web app that shows you, hey, everything is fine. Probably you don't have enough battery capacity, or your battery starts to wear out. In general, to build such a system, I guess most of you already know, you need a solar module. The picture shows a 10-watt module, which is not sufficient in our areas to power such a Wi-Fi device like a TP-Link. But it would be sufficient to run this device in client mode. In order to run it in access point mode at full power for the entire year, you need a 20-watt solar panel. And the picture shows the previous design that I made. It's still around, and it's going to be around, but it has only an AVR 8-bit microcontroller inside. So it needs a serial interface to the router in order to deliver the data to the network. A screenshot with some of the options of the web app. On the left-hand side, that's what you see when you connect to the web app. It gives you status information, and the problematic nodes are on top. In order to have this feature, you need some little device like a Raspberry Pi would do. You cannot run it on the device itself, also not on OpenWRT. And since the device is interconnected with all this measurement data, you can make these fancy graphs where you can see with a look, if you're interested, how the system life or system health is. So that's a photo of the new hardware. The features, yeah, it's an ESP32, so it has all the features of an ESP32. Default, it runs at 160 megahertz. I've tested it. The throughput between two clients at full load is 1.3 megabytes per second, but with debugging turned on. So without debugging, it's probably faster. And at 240 megahertz, it's probably faster too. The device fancies 520 kilobytes of RAM. You see, the sky is the limit. Well, it's not that amazing if you consider that OpenWRT today wants 64 megabytes of RAM minimum, so 128 times more RAM. Yes, I mentioned it before, it's a maximum power point tracker, so it gets more power out of the solar panel. It runs as an access point, as a client, or the combination of both. It has Bluetooth support, so far I'm not using it. In theory, there's a proprietary mesh protocol by Espressif, the makers of that chip, but it's only a spanning tree protocol, not a real mesh. So maybe we can come up with something better, even though there are these limited resources, but it's not implemented yet. The device has one RS-232 port at 3.3 volts for programming and debugging. You can also flash a different firmware if you wish. And you have a second port, for example, to connect another router and read that serial data and communicate with that as well, or an Arduino. And these ports can also be used for other purposes, like I2C, as far as I know. So you have three extra ports to connect sensors and also a temperature sensor. At the moment, I'm using a PTC, a positive temperature coefficient device. But a DHT22, which is popular in the maker scene, can also be attached. Needs a little bit of modification of the firmware. Yes, I also mentioned it. It also operates as a fixed maximum power point tracker, like those cheap maximum power point tracking controllers that are already out there, in order to recharge the battery, even though there is no power left. And the system is designed for lead acid batteries of the V voltage regulated type, so AGM type batteries. I'm using lead since lithium iron or lithium iron phosphate cannot be charged at freezing temperatures, you will destroy those batteries. So even though there is these fancy types of batteries, for this climate, they're just not useful. You will ruin them in the long end. Yeah, the applications, yeah, you can use it just as I intended to use, as a low power Wi-Fi relay in a network of poor people, or if you just want to bring connectivity to remote places, or you can use it to power a more powerful Wi-Fi gear and remotely control it, because there is a power port that can be switched on and off from remote. Yeah, you can also use it as a general purpose solar charge controller with maximum power point tracking feature to charge a battery in a caravan or on a boat or whatever where you see it fit. Or you use it as a sensor node. Well, I've only have these three GPIO pins exposed for sensors. I think you can already do a great deal of things with it. If not, I can consider to add more GPIO or expose more GPIO ports in the next design. There are obviously some limitations. It's a microcontroller after all, so we only have limited resources. And the access point can only handle up to 4 clients, unfortunately. But for a relay between villages, 2 clients or 3 clients are just enough. As far as I know, Wi-Fi timing cannot be adjusted for Wi-Fi long shots. So when you have distances where the Wi-Fi protocol and the slot timings are critical, then you will see some duplicate acknowledgements, for example, that a typical problem. And so at the moment, you cannot adjust it. Maybe somebody has a hint how to do it, but at the moment it's not available. One problem I ran into is that the analog digital converters that I use for measurements are very low precision, actually. I calibrated one of them, and I calibrated the reference voltage, but still it's not very accurate. So probably all ports need to be calibrated. Well, the time is running, so I'll just show this to you. That's the positions of the components on the board and the blocks. Below we have the power horse, the 95% efficiency DC-DC step-down converter. We have an extra P-channel MOSFET to control the power output. It can switch many, many amps if you wish. We have the ESP, the programming interface. There is a DC-DC step-down converter that you can modify, so you can actually undervolt the device if you wish. I experimented with 2.8 volt. It works perfectly. And since the ESP has linear regulators to produce its core currents, you can undervolt it, and therefore the power consumption goes down even more. So if you want to save some power, there is an option to play. I'm just showing you the schematic because, I'm not going to explain it. There's no time. And the result of it all is like at full load, I mentioned it before, it's 540 milliwatt or 0.54 watt. As a client, it's a quarter of a watt. And you can still undervolt it to bring the power demands down. I also mentioned already, NodeMCU is the firmware. You can change it to whatever you wish, but then again, the stuff that I'm providing, you have to re-implement in your favorite tool. Yeah, I guess I mentioned already all of them. One limitation, Espressif, for some reason, they have patched out IP forwarding out of the IP stack, TCP IP stack. I'm going to add it again. And maybe add a minimalistic mesh protocol so these devices can actually interconnect on their own. There is already a proprietary protocol, as I mentioned, but it's only spanning tree. Here is the status page. That's a page that the device generates. So you can, even without a fancy management system, you can go to the nodes individually and check how they are. They will show you, hey, I'm healthy. and it provides a status code. Well, it's probably not that interesting for a human user, but that's what the management system looks for. And it also generates a list of CSV entries. For example, if you generate one every 5 minutes, you have the status of the last 25 minutes, because the list, in order to save some RAM, I only have 5 entries in that CSV list. You can just poll them with curl or wget, and then do whatever you like. Yeah, I mentioned it. You can program it with a simple USB to serial converter at 3.3 volt logic level. You can use NodeMCU tool or NodeMCU uploader to upload or erase Lua files, and with jumper cables you can update the entire firmware make flash if you use the SDK of your development environment that you're using. So that's it. How's the time? No time for questions, I suppose.
No, we're actually very good in time.
Okay.
You still have at least 8 minutes.
Okay, so 8 minutes for your questions. Can you go around with the mic?
You mentioned 60 euro. Is it including...
That's the target price for the complete system.
Including the solar panel?
Wow.
Yeah. Okay.
The battery, this type of battery for an access point costs 15 euro, 15 to 16. Solar module about 25, and then about 20 euros or 15 euros for the device in mass production.
Okay.
The hand-soldered prototypes are, of course, costlier. If I consider, like, I work for, like,
Okay, thanks.
They're hand-soldered. I have six PCBs.
Next question.
Oh. How did you implement these other features that when there's not enough power, that DSP is powered? Is there like another microprocessor on it, or?
Actually, the maximum power point tracking works with an operational amplifier, and that circuitry is analog, and I've designed it in such a way that if there is no control from the ESP, it operates at 16 volts. So even usually the ESP would control a reference voltage that is compared to the voltage coming in from the solar panel. And when that is not influenced by the ESP, so if that DAC is off, it operates at 16 volts. So as an emergency mode.
We still have time for a few more questions.
Come on.
You said one can attach other solar modules and use this as an MPP tracker only. What's the...
Sorry, can I attach what?
You said we can use this device also as an MPP tracker only, right? And power something, not use the Wi-Fi functionality of the ESP.
Well, then there's other devices, but probably not in that class of power, because it's already attractive, I guess, for the amount of capacity that it has, like 70 watts. But of course, if you have Wi-Fi on board, for example, if you operate it in client mode and there is an access point close, it can sometimes send you an update about the status of the system, if it's like a boat or a caravan.
So you get 12 volt regulated from this then, or you just use the battery voltage?
It's battery voltage, and the battery voltage, it floats between typically 14.8 maximum, down to 11.7, that's when the low voltage disconnect by default would kick in. But consumers that are designed for 12 volt systems, they're all fine with that. They usually can handle up to 16 volt, and they start to fail below 10 or 11 volts. And you can also, if you want to have USB power, then you just attach one of these cheap USB to 5 volt power converters. So no, it's not regulated power. The only regulated power you have is 3.05 volts or whatever to power other devices, and it's efficient. So it's a step-down converter, and I took some effort to make it efficient, because it's one place to save, to conserve energy, and this is all about conserving energy in order to make the system cheap. More questions? This one.
Okay, last question.
Did you do range tests in production?
No, I trust that the data is accurate that I saw from other people with these devices. Well, actually, experience from the 8266 was range up to 6 kilometers. I did my own performance tests, but with debugging compiled into the firmware. So I was looking for how much throughput I can actually get from such a low-cost system. And it's 1.3 megabytes per second between two clients. Overclocking it, turning debugging off will make the yield greater. Yeah, but I didn't do a range test. The range is probably pretty good because I'm not using an internal antenna, so you can attach an external antenna. So if you have an antenna with high gain, well, you will get some decent range.
Okay. Now, for a well-done presentation, despite the technical difficulties, please...
Thank you very much.
And also the OIO stage would like to present you one of these, either a mate or a sweet. What would you rather have? I think you can have both, actually. Now that we, with the technical difficulties and everything, let's do that. Thank you very much.